Thank you. So now it's my task to invite Professor Hans Hoppeler at the stage to give a different perspective on individuality, the physiological perspective. So I know that Professor Hans Hoppeler is very well known by many of you in this society. He is also internationally very well known for his contribution to exercise physiology. And most of his career he has spent at the University of Bern. But I want to highlight also that during his career, he has devoted significant time and energy to societies and organizations outside the university, including guiding the Journal of Experimental Biology as the editor-in-chief for the past more than 10 years, and not at least being a key person and a former president of our society, ECSS. Welcome, Hans. Looking forward to your talk.
I'll take a bit of a different take, and I would like to thank first for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here again on the stage of ECSS. Been here a couple of times in very different functions, but never as a plenary speaker, so that's new for me. Now, what sparked the interest, my interest in individuality, is looking at some of the data that we have collected over the year. You see here what we call sedentary VO2 max, which is VO2 max we measured on untrained people who are plausibly indicating that they haven't trained. And as you can see here, some of them were below 30 and some of them were above 60. So there is an enormous span of VO2 max within an adult population. And of course, you know that VO2 max is a basic descriptor of aerobic fitness, but it's also performance and health related. So based on that observation, you can of course ask the question of heritability of VO2 max. How much is it genetically determined on the one hand, and how much is it changed by the environment, for instance, your training? So it's nature versus nurture. And it's not only training, it's the outside world. It could be that people who have a high sedentary VO2 max, when we measure them when they are maybe 25 or 30, that they may have worked out more as children. They not necessarily train now, but they have a different background. So this is also in the context of nurture. Now, interestingly, one of our founding fathers was the first one, to my knowledge, who seriously approached this problem, Vasilis Klisouras. I guess he may be here in the audience, at least he said, because he lent me that slide, that's his slide. He looked at heritability of VO2 max with what we usually did, or often still do today, with studying monozygotic twins versus dizygotic twins. And you see in his study that the VO2 max of mono and dizygotic twins was very similar, around 50 mils per minute and kilogram. But when you plotted twin A against twin B, you can see that the monozygotic twins here fall in a very narrow band, resulting in a very strong correlation. In fact, the correlation here, the R-square, is 0.91, whereas when you correlate twin A to twin B with a dizygotic twin, you have 0.44. So there is a huge difference. And from that, at the time, Vasilis calculated that sedentary VO2 max is 90% genetically determined. That's published, was published in 91. I actually think the data was collected in Switzerland. There are more of these studies. And in fact, and that is alluded to with this graph, is there was even a NASA study where one monozygotic twin flew in space while the other one did, performed exact same thing on the ground. But we'll not talk about NASA stuff now, but what you can see, there are at least five monozygotic twin studies, which all of them with different numbers of mono and dizygotic twins show that the correlation was always significantly higher for the monozygotics than the dizygotic twins. We calculated heritabilities between, let's say, 40 and 90%. So when we look at that, the conclusion from these twin sibling studies is that genetic factors determine more than half of the individual differences in VO2 max. So that is what we can take from this study. An interesting meta-analysis of all twin studies that have ever been done on 17,000 traits, 2,700 studies, and 40 million of twin pairs. Imagine 40 million of twin pairs. Shows that for these traits, the twins generally have relatively high correlation coefficients for everything which is physiological. So this is up in this region here where we have, for instance, VO2 max as one of the traits. And of course, the dizygotic twins are shifted to the left. That's not surprising. What is surprising, and I would like to remember this, is that quite a few of the psychological traits have a low heritability between 20 and 30%. You find them down here. Now, we're here in a sport environment, but the monozygotic twins are underrepresented in Olympic sports. There are not as many as there should be, we don't know why, but there is one very interesting and well-known pair of monozygotic twin that has been reported, where we have data, is Maurizio da Milano and his brother Giorgio. They are identified monozygotic twins. They had the same trainer. They lived at the same place. They were grown up at the same place, had the same trainer, and trained together exactly the same thing. And Maurizio, he was Olympic champion in 1980. He was third in Los Angeles, third in Seoul, and he was fourth in Barcelona. He was 2 times world champion in race walking. His brother, with identical genes and identical family, identical trainer, identical training, was 11th at one Olympic game. Okay, this is interesting. Let's leave that aside. I'll come back to that at the very end. But of course, when you talk about sedentary VO2 max, we have to look not at the meager data points that I've collected. We have to look at the fantastic study that Claude Bouchard has done, which is called the Heritage Family Study, where he collected sedentary VO2 maxes here from a population of 429 individuals. And you can see them ranked here via family means. He calculated the average VO2 max to be 2.5 liters and the heritability, as you would have expected, just about 50%, slightly over 50%. And of this, and I will not come back to that, 30% was maternal inheritance, mitochondrial inheritance. I will not come back to that. So, nature. The range of sedentary VO2 max is more than twofold in plausibly sedentary people. And the genetic component of sedentary VO2 max is some 50%, probably a little bit more. Nurture. And now we specify nurture as trainability. how much can you train now? And there you would say, well, yeah, for aerobic performance, you can do a whole lot of things. I mean, what type of training do you do? There is an interesting recent meta-analysis by Trisha Scribbins, who looked at 40 groups that have trained with different intensities. Low, intermediate, and high intensity. You see, low is up to 70% VO2 max, 71 to 100%, and then 100% and more. She comes to the conclusion that independent on how you train, the gain in VO2 max is about similar. But I also have to say that not everybody would agree, A, and B, of course, the time you spend training is going to be less when you use a high-intensity protocol. Okay. But for the time being, let's assume you can basically take any type of aerobic training and it will increase VO2 max. Now, how does it increase VO2 max? Does it increase VO2 max more when you already have a high or already have a low VO2 max? And again, I have to go back to the fantastic Bouchard study. Trainability and baseline VO2 max? Nothing. Doesn't depend. You know, whether you start out with 20 or 50 mils per minute in kilogram, the delta VO2 max that you can achieve, the maximum is indicated here. You can go so much to the right, is available to everybody. It's independent of VO2 max. That was a surprise. That is, was a little bit of a surprise to me. So, you know, you really, if you are into aerobic performance, you would like to start out here and then have this arrow go for you. But when we look at age and sex, again, trainability of VO2 max is independent of age and independent of sex, and is independent of age and of race, black or whites. It doesn't matter. And when you look at Claude Bouchard's collective data, then we see in a total of here was 98 families. It was about 600, subjects that were measured. You can see that the mean average gain in VO2 max was about 400 milliliters with a fixed training protocol for everybody. And this fixed training protocol involved actually was 3 months of training, three times a week. They started at 50% VO2 max for 30 minutes, and the last 8 weeks they worked for 75% of VO2 max for 50 minutes. So a total, a classical endurance exercise program, and again he calculated the heritability of trainability to be of the range of 50%. But look at the individual data. Actually, a few individuals decreased with this training protocol, and the adherence was strictly controlled, and a few gained as much as almost a liter with the same training protocol. So, taking this data together is what I said, sedentary VO2 max differs by more than twofold. The genetic component is more than 50%. The range of trainability is from zero to a doubling, essentially. And the genetic component of trainability, again, is some 50%. So we have here genetic component, we have it here. And of course, the problem is, what are the genes? What are the genes? So you may know this study because it has was featured very prominently. Montgomery, 1997, in circulation. He looked at used the candidate gene approach, and I've spelled out the definition for those who are not familiar with that type of approach. It tests the effects of genetic variants, alleles, that is, when the two genes differ, the two genes that we have, the one from the mother and one from the father. So when we have different alleles in interesting regions, and it tests how much this allelic difference contributes to the difference in the trait. And he looked at this in 460 army recruits. He looked at the ACE, this is the angiotensin converting enzyme that he thought was an important part of a training adaptation. And you could see that here, as a proxy for increase in VO2 max, we have left ventricular mass. And you can see, depending on which genotype you have, if you have one allele which has a deletion in it, the deletion here, then the training response is much larger than when you don't have none of these alleles in your genetic composition. So that was favored as an approach for a few years. Between 2000 and 2007, a group of people met, they collected all the data, and by 2007, data was published in 2009 in Medicine and Science in Sport and Exercise. They had a total of 214 genes or quantitative trait loci identified, 7 on the X chromosome and 18 mitochondrial genes which were related to some performance characteristics. But, and that is a quote from Bouchard, the candidate gene study in generally were massively underpowered, the results inconclusive or discordant, even for those genes that were most studied, for instance, the ACE gene. So that was a disappointment, and this wasn't done after 2007. We have stopped collecting these candidate genes. In comes the genome-wide association studies. Use a genome-wide association studies. And I have here plotted on top a so-called Manhattan plot, where you make a hypothesis-free analysis of a genome-wide set of genetic variants. We call them SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms. It's basically also alleles, and you test them for significant association with a phenotype, like trainability. You can see here an example where this works. You have massive number of SNPs here, 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 that go over the detection limit, and we call that a genome-wide association. Significant genome-wide association. And this is done on the data 99 families of the heritage family study, the heritage white, the white families, genomic predictors, published 2011. And this line here is the same line as this line here. It's the same altitude, different picture. Nothing stands out, really. And I must say now, this may be partially related to the fact that this study also was underpowered, because there were several hundred people. Today, genome-wide association studies sometimes have 200,000 subjects, and they go up to 1 million currently. So maybe it's part of this, the fact that it is underpowered. But let's have a look. What they found is that the distribution, again, of the increase in VO2 max, less than 100,
the frequency, how often it was observed, plus then a liter. That was their data of the difference. They used 320,000 SNPs. 39 were significant, and with 21, they could calculate with stepwise multiple regression that they could account for 40%, 49% of VO2 max. So that when a person had less than 9 SNPs, then his increase in VO2 max was 200 milliliters. These were 36 people. And if you had more than 19 of these 21 SNPs, your increase in VO2 max was more than 600 milliliters, and he had 52 subjects in this category. So this still looks reasonably good. But these genome-wide association studies, this particular study, had none of the SNPs that reach genome-wide significance. And only 5 out of the 15, remember we had 21 before, only 5 out of the 15 strongest SNPs showed partial replication. Partial replication means you find it in a different population when you use your SNPs and predict it in a different population. So here is an example. This is the founding study, the heritage white. These are the SNPs. They predict, the genotype predicts this. And when you take another study, here it was the dose response to exercise, it cannot be replicated. It doesn't work. So, what do we do here? What does Bouchard tell us? In 2015, in the British Journal of Sports Medicine, he came to the conclusions that the genes do not explain the individuality of the training response. Why? He proposed that exercise genomics is not good enough, and we need a paradigm shift. We have to combine genomics with transcriptomics and epigenomics. And I want to take you through these steps and see to what this leads. So remember, we have to look at transcriptomics and epigenomics. So in a recent paper, you can see again, this is what I've showed before in the original publication. You have the delta VO2 max, small, large, and how often it occurs. And you would like to have predictors for this variation, for this individuality. And you would like to have also a biological reason. You would like to know why you have this, okay? So, of course, you can use gene-wide association studies, transcriptomics, proteomics, metabolomics, epigenetics, whatever you want. What basically is in here is that let's take now the situation where we train. Let's say we train a muscle cell. When we train a muscle cell, we know that within 2 months of training, we increase mitochondrial content by 30%. If you train half a year, you may increase it by 60%. So there is a large change. Trainability depends on the local response. The local response is brought to the cell, to the muscle cell, that the yellow thing here, by hypoxia, oxidative stress, exosome, hormones, myokines, substrates, adipokines. This is all coming from outside to the muscle cell. Inside the muscle cell, you have various signaling systems that interact with each other, which then produce the change in protein content, which are responsible for the change in function. I have looked at these networks a little bit more in a more detailed view, And you can see here, when we compare these two, calcium signaling, here we have calcium signaling going on in a muscle cell that is trained for endurance. We have oxidative stress here in the scheme, here how it happens in an idealized fashion. AMPK signaling, HIF signaling, essentially hypoxia, mTOR, going over to strength training and translation. Here we have VEGF signaling shear stress integrates as well. PPAR, which is essentially substrate signaling, and all of these pathways impinge on PGC1-alpha, which is a transcriptional coactivator, serves as a platform which is then enabling the genome to produce about 800 or 900 proteins which make up a mitochondria, because now you need 30% or 60% more mitochondria and the corresponding numbers of capillaries. So that's how it actually happens. So what you have here is in fact a transcriptomic network. And this transcriptomic network, in this small and reduced sketch that I have here, is maybe 30 or 40 proteins. Okay. Now, how do we go on from here? Trainability is an emergent property of the regulation of transcription. Trainability emerges through the interaction of those proteins, the feedback systems that we have, and the feed-forward systems that we have. Trainability cannot be understood by the study of the behavior of the individual components of the network, nor the genes that encode them. This is simply not possible. And I have given you here this picture. This is Dali's picture of Lincoln. When you squint your eyes, you can see Lincoln. You have to squint your eyes and you see the picture is in St. Petersburg in the Dali Museum. And this is, I've been there last spring, so that's why it came to mind. What it means is you can see here, you can see the body of Gala, the muse of Dali. This picture doesn't tell you anything about Lincoln. You can study it as much as you want. You will not gain any insight. And this is difficult to comprehend. But we have here an interesting new book by the president of IUPS, Dennis Noble, the International Union of Physiologists. And, we can understand trainability as an emergent function of the transcriptomic network. And Dennis Noble says that the question of function depends on the level we are considering. It has no meaning below the level at which the relevant function is integrated. That is, we can only question these systems top down. We cannot question them bottom up. And in the context of trainability here, is trying to understand it on the level of the proteins or genes is doomed to failure. It's a loss of time, basically. Not the search in itself, we do not have to do that, but the understanding is doomed to failure. And that's not all. Because we have the epigenome. The epigenome is a broad array of chemical marks that decorate DNA and its proteins, telling the cell which genes to express and which to keep silent. Actually, the genes don't do anything by themselves. If you put genes in a test tube, they will remain in the test tube and nothing happens. Genes are operated by the cell. and the cell are controlled by the organism, and the organism in the environment. And that's where the epigenome comes in, because the epigenome tells the cell, for instance, by histone acetylation, which parts of the genes have to be translated, because it can only be translated when it is open, because DNA is wound around nucleosomes and cannot be translated usually. It's in condensed form. And you have all the information, the genetic information in every cell, so you have to tell the cell what is going on. And in addition to that, gene expression is additionally controlled by DNA methylation, which is very finely targeted and can work directly on gene expression. So what I see then is trainability is under epigenetic control, because in the environment controls epigenetics and epigenetics controls transcription, as we have seen. So I come to an end, but not without trying to predict Olympic success, because, as I said, we are in a sports environment here. We have again Maurizio and Giorgio, the two monozygotic twins. They were measured thoroughly at age 40. I guess they must have been similar at age 20 when they did compete. BMA, squat jump, VO2 at 9 and VO2 max were very similar, was of course higher, but only Maurizio, the winner, was measured. But what was very different indeed, was some psychological traits. Reaction to anger, anger expression was massively different. And remember, these traits have a very low heritability. So in conclusion, sedentary VO2 max and trainability are multigenetic, are strongly genetically determined, but highly variable. They are emergent properties of the transcriptomics and epigenetics of the cell. What we need is the understanding of the component in the context of the whole, the top-down and not the bottom-up approach. Related to sport success, it means that, of course, a high VO2 max is necessary, but it's not sufficient. For Olympic success, you require personality traits that have a low heritability and may depend on idiosyncratic events in an individual's lifetime. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hans. And we would like to call Roberta once again to the stage and would like to enhance first the dialogue between the keynote speakers. Probably they have questions to each other.
So, given these two very different perspectives on individuality, did it stimulate to ask your competitor here a question?
I don't think he's really a competitor, he's a partner. Well, yeah, there was something that I was really interested in, because it's a problem that I think both the natural sciences and the social sciences share. You ended up showing the relevance of contingency. I would call it serendipity. And I think that is something that we should try to pattern somehow. It's very, very difficult to do so. It's not just a matter of psychological, personality traits, but very often it has to do with, the particular events in a biography that somehow shape the actual response of the individual. And I think they can be patterned. So they can be patterned socially. So there may be, a particular disease which has happened at a certain time, and it is a pattern which we can find in the life of many people. So this is something that perhaps we can share together and see whether we can, find the common solution.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think that, you know, the part that you showed, and I was fascinated from, you know, looking at the phenomenon from a completely different perspective that I'm used to, is that you have your effects are basically higher, I'm in the environment sphere, basically. They're superimposed on epigenetic, and as you said, we touch exactly where the individual events do shape a person, so that he, with a given set of genes, then can or cannot perform and become an Olympic winner in this particular context. But of course, it's relevant for diseases and everything. So yes, I think it's that area higher up than the individual.
Yeah, and I suppose that with new methodologies that are developing, which are very much related to simulational models and the possibility of factoring in a number of different variables, both of a biological, genetic, medical, social, psychological kind, perhaps we will be able to get to models which are, you know, clearer. And at that point, then the question would be probably philosophical. Do we really want to be that clear about what makes an individual? You know, do we want to be so precise, or is this again something, you know, it's something I ask myself, is this again something that perhaps is a bit dangerous, or?
Maybe the last comment.
Well, yeah, the last comment is, of course, that this is exactly what natural sciences have tried to do with this genome-wide association studies. And I'm happy to tell you, as I told, it won't work. It's not the way it will work. Okay, thank you.
Let this be the last word. It didn't work. So give them an applause.
So thank you very much, Roberta and Hans, and also Bente for chairing this session. A really interesting session where a lot of dialogue can happen even between natural and social scientists. I have the honor to give you your presence for being a presenter in the plenary session. Could you help me, please? So I just want to show to all of you that every plenary speaker, and you too, Bente, you will get a little symbol and a memory of our region. It's a coal miner, a handmade coal miner, and all your names are graved into, and you have always a memory to ECSS 2017 in MetropolisRuhr area, and this one is for you, Hans.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This one is for you, Roberta. Thank you very much. And this one's for you.
So now also I want to thank everybody, but please stay where you are, because now it's my privilege to invite our fantastic president Tim Cable on the stage, because we are just going on with the program. Yes.